time is now 6:01. I'd like to call this meeting to session. Please rise and join me in the invocation. Lord, we come to you today asking for your guidance, wisdom, and support as we begin this meeting. Help us to engage in meaningful discussion, allow us to grow closer as a group, and nurture the bonds of community. Fill us with your grace, Lord, as we make decisions that might affect members of our community. And continue to remind us that all that we do here today and all that we accomplish is for the pursuit of truth, for the greater glory of you, and for the service of humanity. We ask these things in your name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Now we recite the U.S. Pledge.
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
On the Texas flag, I pledge allegiance to thee,
Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
Thank you. We do have a quorum tonight. Council Place 1, David Johns. Council Place 5, Ms. Gloria Cantu. I am Jake Silva, Council Place 3. Nick Nissen, Place 2. And Gerard Jimenez, Place 4. At this time, we will be taking citizen comments. Please state your name for the record.
My name is Doug Axto and I live in Shannon Ridge, and I'm presenting this citizen comment regarding fiber connection. If I may approach, I have some handouts for you. First thing, I'd like to thank the Mr. Baker and Ms. Turner for the iWire 365 meeting, and it's kind of supersedes what I'm trying to accomplish here, but I want to do a citizen comment anyway. So I want to thank you, council members, and the mayor, which is, she's absent. But, the reason for my citizen comment is that Floresville and the surrounding subdivisions do not have fiber connection, with the exception of a few selected locations that I'm aware of, like school, library, and some businesses. Fiber will provide high-speed internet, TV, and voice, which is home phone, capability to all residents of Floresville and surrounding area, including the businesses. The benefits of fiber is to provide connectivity to all city buildings, which will provide instant access to any and all departments' needs, and will provide one-on-one video or group presentations when needed for time efficiency and effectiveness between departments. And city and county will be able to coordinate faster with emergencies, including police and fire. School system will be able to provide more connectivity with students and their parents and increase students' potential as they will be able to do more research for school projects, which of course would include the universities when they come home for summer breaks, etc. Residents may have the potential of saving money between their current services and fiber services, potentially bring more business to the community, potentially bring more citizens to the community, which will increase the number of children for the school district, and increase spending in the community. Great service to enhance promoting the city for individuals and groups to come in for events that would use the hotels and food establishments and potentially become a revenue source. Of course, there are several more benefits as far as imagination to expand on. There are also some roadblocks to overcome. Coordinating with the provider, the county, coordinating contracts with Phelps for usage of their poles with the provider, if it's going to be using the poles, otherwise it can go underground, and funding potential legislators and or federal grants. There are several more roadblocks, but they can all become overcome if all interested parties work together and come to agreements. I'd like to thank you all for allowing me to write this comment. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any more comments this evening? Okay, with that, we'll be moving on to old business. CNA to approve meeting minutes for the special council meeting on March 6, 2017. Does anybody have any comments or questions on these minutes?
I move to approve the minutes for the special council meeting on March 6, 2017.
We have a motion to approve on the table. Do we have a second?
A second.
Motion and a second to approve. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Motion passed. Old business B, CNA to approve meeting minutes for the regular council meeting on March 3rd, 2017. 23rd, I apologize. Okay, we have a motion. Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor? Motion passes. Thank you. 1C, CNA to approve meeting minutes for the special council meeting on March 30th, 2017. Any comments on this?
Go ahead and make the move to approve.
Motion to approve.
I'll second.
And a second by Councilman Nissen. All those in favor? Moving on. Presentation and discussion. Introduction of a new city employee, the Public Works Director, Mr. Mark Velasquez, New York City Manager.
Well, it is a pleasure and honor, and I want to thank you all again for giving the opportunity. I know we had to make some amendments and some changes to the budget to put this position back in. I do want to, he's here, and he'll be coming to all our city council meetings. He'll be presenting on parks, streets, and some other projects. And I know some of you may have had a chance to meet him, and he's housing, he housed him back to the sewer plant itself. So our biggest project is, he's had an opportunity to meet with some of our vendors, but he has a whole lot to do. But I won't steal this thunder and I'll introduce you to Mark and he can tell you about himself. Mark?
Thank you, ma'am. Esteemed Mayor Pro Tem and Council, my name is Mark A. Velasquez. I come from Pearsall, Texas, and at this point in time, I'd like to tell you a little bit about myself. I'll be brief. I get to be a part of this wonderful community, this wonderful town. I'm coming from the city of Seeley, where I was the director of public works there as well. I was there for about 2 years. And before that, I was doing some work in oil and gas. Again, as everyone knows, oil and gas is very lucrative until certain things happened in the economy and they were downsizing, things like that. I've also worked as the director of public works for the city of Pearsall, which is my hometown. Before I did that, however, I had the privilege and the honor of being in the Navy as a CB for 10 and a half years. I was a CB, which is construction battalion. I got my start in the construction field, dealing with water, wastewater, plumbing, heating, air conditioning, all those things. And then, as you might imagine, like the military often does, is they start giving you some cross training before you know it. There's a hammer in your hand, and then you're driving a piece of equipment, and then you're going so on and so forth. So I've been fortunate enough to have my whole adult life in construction and infrastructure in some way, shape, or form. And I bring those tools to you tonight and hopefully for a long, bright future in this community. I've jumped in with both feet, so to speak, and so far, so good. My head is staying above water. There are a lot of projects. There are a lot of things going on here in the city of Floresville, which is a good thing. and I hope to be able to add all the tools I have in my tool belt to this community and become an asset. So I know it was brief, it was short, but at this point in time, I'm willing to accept any questions of anybody.
Thank you. Council?
Just welcome.
Thank you. Yes, welcome. Thank you.
Welcome. Thank you.
Moving on to item 2B.
Yeah.
City of Floresville Investments.
Thank you. Normally this would be something that Connie would introduce because it's a financial issue, but we want to save her voice and we don't want her hacking all over the place. But we have Linda Patterson here. And Linda Patterson, just to give you a little brief history, did our investments for us. It is a fee service basis, and so we're hoping that we can do some fees. And I know some of the council had a chance to talk to our auditors today, but Linda's here to present. And there's two items on there, Mr. Per Tem, to let you know that there's two items right behind each other in reference to Ms. Patterson. Okay? Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Linda Patterson. I'm out of Austin. I have a registered investment advisory firm in Austin, Patterson & Associates. And I think I'll reverse the order here and talk about your investment policy first. I'm very involved with all we manage in public is public funds. So we manage about $5 million worth of public funds here in Texas. And all of the public funds are controlled by the Public Funds Investment Act, which is the state statute that assures that your funds are very safe all the time, that you are meeting your objectives of safety and liquidity, as well as making the money work for you, as well as getting that additional yield. So part of the Investment Act is a requirement for you, the governing body, to approve your investment policy once a year. The reason being, and a lot of what's in the statute is a rotating requirement, like the investment policy that comes up once a year, the investment quarterly reports that come up once a quarter, all of it is to make sure that the governing body is involved in, understands what's happening with their money. So your investment policy has to be approved by the governing body once a year. It got lost last year and didn't get approved, but that's why it's on your agenda tonight. And I just wanted to run you through some of the main parts of it. The policy is there to set up the objectives, to set up the guidelines for the investment, and it's very much built on the safety of public funds and then the liquidity, so that you have money available to pay the bills, to pay new employees, and then also to diversify so that you have spread your risk, and finally the yield. Your main controls in the policy are, one, that you can't buy anything longer than 2 years, so very short investments, since many of your funds stay in the city for that period of time, but also the weighted average maturity of it is much shorter, 270 days, so that you're always assured that that liquidity is available to you. So I just wanted to let you know that your policy is geared towards safety, but it's also geared towards making the money work. And the second part of what the ladies have been talking about this evening is your contract with us. As I said, we are registered investment advisors, registered by the SEC. And what we are doing with Floresville is that we're available anytime anyone in the staff needs us, so that we feel that we're there for you as extended staff. We're there to help with your policies, your procedures, internal controls, banking, anything that has to do with the treasury operation, which is money moving through the city. And we've worked with everybody for about 2 years now, and now I can really get excited because we're finally talking about rates that are on the left side of the decimal points, so we can actually start talking about 1% and 2%. And I think you'll notice that as these rates go up, that your investments really mean a lot to you, how you do your banking and how you do your investments, because they can generate a lot of money. I was in a previous life the city treasurer of the city of Fort Worth, and I used to tell my council that it's profits, not taxes. And the same thing when I was your deputy state treasurer and chief investment officer for the state of Texas, and it was the same thing under Kay Bailey Hutchison. It's making that money work. And so I would be glad to answer any detailed questions for you, or I'll sit down and go away.
Thank you for that. Council, do you have any questions?
Not yet. New business.
Thank you, Mrs. Patterson. So we're moving on to new business. If it's okay with council, I'd like to go ahead and move items B and C up to the top of the list. That is 3B, the CNA to approve the renewal of Patterson & Associates contract for investments. Council, have any comments?
I'd like to make a motion to accept it.
We have a motion by Councilman Nissen to accept.
I'll second.
And a second by Councilman Jimenez. At this time, we have time for citizen comments. No comments? All those in favor? Motion passes. Thank you. 3C. CNA to approve resolution 2017-007, the City of Floresville Investment Policy. Any comments, questions? I'll entertain a motion.
I'd like to make a motion to accept this.
Motion by Councilman Nissen to accept.
Second.
And a second by Councilman Jimenez. Citizen comments? All those in favor? Motion passes. Moving back up to 3A, CNA to approve street closures for the Lions Club Car Show, presented by Councilman Nissen.
Yes, when I brought three guests with four guests now, and I'd like to have Jim Glenn introduce himself and Mr. Reed, because both of them are very involved, and we're added some extra footage of streets.
If needed.
Huh?
If we need it.
If we need it, and that will take on C Street, we'll go up, we're asking to go up to Wilson County News. And then on 3rd Street, we'd like to go to Texas Lodge and stop there. And they'll explain why. And this is the horse here.
Introduce you.
Glenn May.
Good evening. My name is Glenn May. I'm with the Floresville Lions Club. This is our fourth year of doing the car show. This year, we've contracted out to a company that does this professionally. In hopes to grow the car show much larger and get more participation. Last year we had just over 50 cars, and we had 4th Street and C Street, half of those streets blocked off, and it fit pretty well. If we get more than probably 75 or 80 cars, we're going to need more room. Right now we don't know how many cars we've got coming because it is a contract thing, and they're telling us that usually the last 2 weeks is when they get all the cars registered. With that, we're also going to have, we've invited the South Texas Blood Tissue Center to come down for a blood drive. We will have the Lions Mobile Eye Screening Unit do an eye screen free of charge. And we'll also have the DPS recruiters there with their, I believe they're going to bring their safety trailer, and they're going to bring their Challenger down. It's a pretty awesome display. We're also going to have approximately 30 vendors around the courthouse area. We'll do that mostly in the grass area and off the road. We're going to have a DJ that's going to play for approximately 4 hours. He'll probably go over, but we've contracted him for 4 hours, plus the award show. And this year we're going to try a new thing, which is a Kid Q. It's basically like an adult barbecue, only the ages are 5 to 11 and 12 to 18. I'll let Midri talk about that one.
So the kid queue was started a little over a year ago at the Turning Bird in Pleasanton, and it started with, I think, about 20, 30 children. They were kids that followed the barbecue scene with the adult. As it's grown, they've done over probably 20 different barbecues throughout the state of Texas. So what we've done is the Fourth Line, but we've partnered up with Steve Jimenez, who runs the Kids Cube as a nonprofit, to have the kids break apart, have their own circuit. So they'll break apart from just being just something fun for the kids to do while they're there, but hopefully it'll be a standalone barbecue cook-off for kids, just like when the women broke away and they started that. So we're looking to have exactly like approximately 50 applicants come, kids, and participate. We have sponsors from Western Wood, WW Wood out in Pleasanton. Richard Brothers Chevrolet has come to be a sponsor. I've talked to Edmund Prusky with Prusky's Meat Market to come to sponsor the meat. And so it's a pretty neat little event. The kids have their own little barbecue. They'll have their own charcoal. They'll have one adult in there with one child. And they barbecue for approximately an hour, and they turn in, they do pork steaks. They get some pork steaks to do it. So we're looking for volunteers. So any of the council members or employees want to come up that day and taste a lot of the kids' pork steaks. I did it in Pleasanton, I couldn't even eat anymore, of course. So it's a really neat event. And it's a good way just to grow our community with our youth. So we find this is pretty interesting, pretty neat that the first time they'll ever have a kid stand on barbecue was Dark Forestville, so we can say we were the first.
Council, have any questions?
I would like to defer to our city manager about the street closures, just to make sure that there are.
Okay, so because I have a reference, I use the Goober Games, and so this will be the same kind of closure on C Street for the Goober Games. And so as you see on the open for emergency lanes, so those businesses will have to be closed during this time. So on that side, police go in, is there lane going up? They will still be able to operate, and traffic will still be able to come through. And so we had this last year, same location, and it worked out very well. Mark has the layout, and so the guys will provide the lighters and things like that. And then the other part of it, because most of it contained in the parking lot, we shouldn't have any problem. So staff will be sharing with the police. We've already shared with Public Works, but historically we had no issue with that. I'm glad the location's here. I'm not quite sure if we put in your porta potty. I didn't see that. For the people, because it worked along that camp, so Goober Games, and so we'll have that going. But I think this will be a really good, well-attended event, and so hopefully, if you all approve, I can put it on my Facebook, because you and I spent a lot of time on Facebook. We can let them know.
Okay, of course. Yeah, everything's really great for the city of Portsmouth and everything going. Just make sure that y'all talk to all the individuals that are in the downtown area. Let them know what's going on.
We do this roughly every year. We talk to them, let them know. So they can come out and either keep their stores open if they'd like to open up, they knew they were closed, or if they like to come set up a separate booth and okay. Do that. So, and we'll have a reference and a resource table, and that's a good thing.
Just to let them know ahead of time.
Like a little map saying, here's park like mine, you can go shop for clothes, you know, things like that. We don't want to hurt anybody, but we to help us.
And I want to thank you all very much for coming up and doing this. Sounds like a great event.
It does. Thank you. If there's no more questions, I'll entertain a motion.
I'll make the motion for the Lions Club.
Okay. No motion?
I'll second.
And second by Councilman Jimenez. Any citizen comments? No comments? I'll take a vote. All those in favor?
Just you.
I have to abstain, Commander Club.
He has no personal benefit.
So he can vote for
motion passes.
Unless there's something he's getting that we don't know about.
Maybe some free scraps.
Okay, moving right along, we have 3B. I'm sorry, 3P.
Just passed.
CNA to approve resolution 2017-006 in support of the Wilson Area Children's Foundation's 15th annual R&R Highway Breakfast. I believe we have a representative.
Well, I suppose I have
you, sir.
That's true. Your name's on this.
That's right. This started about 20 years ago, down when I had a little teeny ranchito on the river down Slaughterhouse Road from Poe. And we were trying to get some people together to take care of referrals from the school districts. And Ben Reed, wherever he ran off to back there, was referring children back then to our church school at the church, and my wife and I were teaching that class, and we got these referrals, and out of that, we started what 5 years later became the Wilson Area Housing Foundation, because initially it focused on housing exclusively. Since then, this has morphed into a formal organization and a pretty elaborate effort to provide assistance to people referred to us by the Floresville or the FISD, the Potham ISD, and Stockdale ISD. And what we basically do, so that all of you kind of have a straightforward understanding, is the Cowboy Breakfast is our primary fundraiser. Last year we had a nice grant from the Valero Foundation because it was all focused on kids. And that caused us to change our name this year from the Floresville Housing Foundation to use the word Wilson Area Children's Foundation, because their whole focus and the reason they gave us the grant was children. It's always been on children, and that's been our focus, but we put housing in the name and it kind of misled people. So anyway, here's the deal on the Cowboy Breakfast. Let's get right to it. The plates at the door are $10, tables for those that want a table are $500. And half a table is $250, and if you get a full table, you get 8 chairs. If you get a half a table, you get 4. And it's our fundraiser for an auction, and it's an all-you-can-eat event. It's at the Show Barn. We moved from Sacred Heart to the Show Barn about 4 years ago, because we just outgrew it, and we didn't like our tablecloths getting blown off at night. And it's all volunteer, and a lot of this is supported out of my office. Friend of the public works on this good percentage of the time at my expense, and I'm glad to do it, and I'm glad to provide the support for the community. But this is our effort to give back to the community, and we run about $35,000 to $40,000 a year through the budget. One of the most successful things we've done is about 4 years ago, we started providing clothing on tax-free holiday for our kids going back to school, and last year we did about 110
kids and fours over there. Wilson County, you probably get close to 170 kids.
And that was to the tune of $50 a head, and it was very beneficial for people, and the people at Walmart give us a free lane, and so we load those lanes up and run it from about 8:30 in the morning until about 10, not excuse me, until about 1:30 in the afternoon. And so it's a good benefit to the community, and the families involved, it's a good turnaround for them. So just ask your endorsement and support, and more importantly, we'd like to ask you to be there. We do provide the first responders at the Sheriff's Office of the city, and a volunteer
EMS
free tickets to go. So it's a good get-together community event, and I think that's
nice. And we have purchased a table for this event.
You know
what? The city has purchased a table for this event.
So does the council have any questions, comments, concerns?
No, when will you have a girl in the barn and move in here?
probably the only reason we're not here is we're still at the stage where we probably feel a little swamped here. But we're hoping to grow enough in another year or two to maybe make that change. Okay? We'll see how many tables we sell this year and see what it looks like. The Show Barn did have an extension this year, you know, and so we'll see if we fill that extension. And if the answer is yes, then my answer to you would be yes.
And the wind don't blow that hard in here.
Well, the wind blows in here pretty hard sometimes. Anyway, with that in mind, any questions from citizens or the council?
I think this is great. I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much that y'all are doing this for the community, especially for the needed children. And we thank y'all so much for y'all's work.
You're welcome. Enjoy doing it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. At this time, I'll entertain a motion.
I'll go ahead. Resolution 2017-2017-006 in support of the Wilson County Wilson Area Children's Foundation annual Karen Mark Award.
So we have a motion to approve from Councilwoman Cantu. To approve. Second.
I'll second.
And we have a second by Councilman Nissen. Citizen comments? If there's no comments, I'll take a vote. All those in favor?
I think you wanted to say something.
No, I just wanted to thank you for what you've done for the community.
Oh.
That was the only comment. Thank you.
Thank you, sorry. Motion passed. Thank you.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
We move to 3E. CNA to approve final plat for 608 B Street. We have our community development.
Good evening, Council. The 608 E Street came before you about a month ago to subdivide 0.7 acres with Mr. James Letter being the property owner. It was approved by PNC and City Council. What they have brought forth tonight is their final plat to record, which would require your signature. But nothing else has changed with these projects. It's just a plat to be recorded on the approved subdivided property.
I've got a question. So this 0.70 acres is going to be divided into 0.35?
Two lots. One is 0.40 and one is 0.30.
What are the sizes of these lots?
This one is 99, or almost right around 100 by 130. The other one is 100 feet by 175.
Where would the entry be? Is that coming off of East Street?
Yes, sir. Where you see the 20-foot utility easement and utility and access easement on the last page of your packet.
Is that a city easement?
It is. It will be. Yes, it will be used for utilities and access to the back lot.
It will be dedicated as part of the
Yes. Lot, yes.
It can be used as a driveway then?
Yes, sir. It's also an access easement. It's 20 foot wide.
What?
20 foot wide.
Is that wide enough for a fire truck to get in if there's a fire back there or something?
I believe so, yes.
It's enough for one way traffic, but not two way traffic.
Correct.
I'm going to go ahead and move to approve.
Do we have any more comments from council before we entertain a motion? Okay, we have a motion on the table to approve from Councilwoman Cantu. Is there a second?
I'll second.
We have a second by Councilman Nissen. At this time, we have citizen comments. Any citizen comments? Okay, I'll take a vote. All those in favor? 4-0. Motion passed.
Thank you. Have the final plat to be signed up for me. Thank
you. And we have 3F. CNA to approve a variance for 1106 Fifth Street.
Thank you. This is also a project that went through planning and zoning that was approved and recommended for council to approve. The city staff has also looked at it and we're recommending approval. In your packet, the property owner, Mr. Richard Dimmer, has got signatures from his neighbors that are not opposing him building a storage building on an existing slab that does not meet the setback requirements.
The neighbors don't mind?
No, that is the last page of your packet that says date and online.
I'll make a motion to approve it.
Before we entertain a motion, do we have any comments?
Yeah, are they going to build right on this slab? Will that,
it's an existing slab.
Yep, when you look at the pictures, the slab's broken.
It'll undergo a flat work inspection before it's a final.
Any other comments from council? Question? So we have a motion on table from to approve from Councilman Jimenez. Do we have a second?
I'll second the motion.
Second by Councilman Nissen. Citizen comments? No citizen comments? I'll take a vote. All those in favor? 4-0. Motion passes. 3G, CNA to approve a final plat with a variance for the 6-inch water main.
This is a project that staff is really excited about that's coming in. It is between 10th Street and J Street. It's a two-lot subdivision. We have our city engineer here, Mr. Larry Heimer, to answer any engineering questions on the variance. It has gone through planning and zoning, was approved. Phelps has approved it, TxDOT has approved it, and city staff has approved it. It is 8 duplexes.
When you're saying city staff, what do you mean?
City staff is recommending for approval.
Planning and zoning.
And it is 8 duplexes. That's
not city staff.
She is.
Recommending it to be approved. It is 8 duplexes with three commercial spaces for office space to lease.
I got a copy. We're going to meet. How come we don't have a copy in our book?
You don't have a copy of it?
No.
The copy is folded. This is the
copy. Right after G, right?
You don't have the copy. It's on G.
On G?
On G.
G. It's folded.
It's folded now.
On the last page.
Okay, here.
I got this one. Is that what it's doing?
This is.
Yes, you were at the planning and zoning.
Yeah, I guess it was. Okay, I'll give it up.
It's the same packet that was at the planning and zoning.
Yeah, it's sort of blank here.
I was going to ask you, do the neighbors know that it's going to be a duplex?
Duplex, they have them. They do not know at this moment. It still hasn't come for any building permit. This is right now, we're just asking for a final plat and a variance. But as far as building plans, we have building
permits.
So
what's going to happen if we vote to pass this and then the citizens don't allow it?
Then it will come back before planning and zoning, and they'll maybe make some changes, some revisions, and try to address.
Don't you think it should be the other way around?
They will try to address any comments.
I said, don't you think that you're supposed to recommend that it's the other way around, find out whether your neighbors see that everything's going to be okay before you make or allow someone to spend all this money on?
Well, we don't have that in our ordinance to do that at this time. When we have a public hearing for them to rezone, then we'll notify all those in our neighbors.
Okay.
Mayor, if I may, just to say that closest establishment, there are apartments adjacent to that. There's not a lot of single family homes. You also have.
That wasn't the question. I just, you know, if I'm going to do something like this, I would rather go find out that it's okay with the neighboring people and make sure that it's going to be okay for me to do this, to spend all this money on engineering and everything else.
Well, how the ordinance is written right now, it's required to do that for moving in local home. If you want to add that in our consultation process, you can add that kind of language to say going forward that they can do the same kind of thing they have to do with the mobile home. Something that you may want to add to the ordinance as we're going through this codification process.
This property already meets business and residential zoning?
It will have, part of it will have to be rezoned.
You're bringing this to see if the council even wants to go forward with anything.
With the final plat.
Before they go out to get all this rezoning. Because that's where the money's going to come in, is to pay for the rezoning. Start
paying for the rezoning?
Not for the zoning, for the building permit.
The building permit?
Yes, sir. And I have the, our engineers are getting the engineering questions for them as well, and the developer.
One of the issues, though, that I think the council was kind of raising is the water system and the sewage system going to be adequate in the plat process to meet the zoning that's proposed? That's where the two interfaces.
That wasn't a question asked.
Sir?
That was not a question.
I'm.
So we just want questions to be asked.
I'm trying to figure out where the 10th, okay, 10th Street is 181, right?
Yes, ma'am.
And then,
J.
So it'd be 181 and J Street?
In that area, yes.
Where that,
Car wash is?
On the other side.
The other side of the car, next to Moses and Tux, behind Moses and Tux there, or? Where the old radio station is?
Yes, right there.
They're going to tear down that.
All that?
It's empty lot there.
Oh, and the empty lot, or are they going to do the whole thing? Just in the corner?
There's a road there.
Right, it's 10th and J, and I believe 9th Street.
Is it where the trailer houses are now, or is it across the street from the trailer house?
Across the street.
But you got regular residential area.
And they will have to rezone for the commercial part of this project.
But those people that live in those houses, you know, shouldn't they be consulted?
They will be in the public hearing before they rezone.
Well, what would their place be if they don't want that?
We do not have that in our ordinance at this time. We just have to hold a public hearing to notify the residents that they are rezoned.
They say they don't want it next to them?
Then that would be at the council.
Just to be sure that we're clear here, this CNA is for the water main that will supply a building of this nature. They haven't gone through the process of rezoning, which would trigger the notice to the neighbors.
That is correct.
So this would just put a water line out there that would supply the town.
That's correct. This is for final plat and variance.
So that's where the engineer needs to come up and explain how the water line is.
Well, see.
Well, the water line's below the middle. It's the residents.
No, this is a loop.
It's the residents that we don't know whether they're going to want it or not.
We're not there yet. That's.
No, but that's what you need to do first. It's kind of like when that gentleman came in, everybody signed that they didn't want to come in, but the council still approved it. But they had to find out to see if they were able to build that. You understand what I'm saying?
I understand, but our problem that we have is we need to fix that before we change this in the middle of what we're doing.
No, I understand.
Maybe that's where our problem comes in.
But we need to find out first if they're going to even allow before we even bring a 6-inch main.
You can't bring a 6-inch main until the public hearing goes all in effect. This is just to let them spend the money to get it all okay.
Yeah, but why spend the money if they're not going to allow it? That's what I'm getting at. You know, if I was in this business, you know, I would. Okay.
Maybe the engineer has something to add here.
Call, unfortunately.
My name's Larry Heimer, council, and I reviewed the plans, and the only reason I raised the question on the size of the main, the city of Floresville has adopted San Antonio Water Systems, which is SAWS regulations related to water service and standards and specifications. And SAWS, when you have a use that's not single family, the minimum size of water main that they have in their standards is 8-inch. And so I just raised that as a review comment. The project is getting access off of the whole 181. But there is a proposed loop connection from your existing 6-inch main in 181 back to a 6-inch main in J Street. So there's water feeding into the project from both directions. The engineer for the project has done a flow test and reviewed the flow counts, and it does meet the fire code requirements as far as adequate water supply. So I recommend approval of the variance.
Larry, could you repeat that, the last
sentence? I recommended approval of the variance because they are connecting the two mains. They're actually improving the city's distribution system because they have a connection to 2 points. It's a loop connection between J Street and the main and US 181. Now, the access to the project is only coming from US 181. There's no connection to J Street.
Pardon. Okay, one of the questions I have, and I don't know, I guess you should be familiar since you're the engineer, but we're having lots of sewer problems in that area. Are we going to be, is it going to be, we're going to be able to handle something like that again in that area?
Yes, this is not a lot of fault, I mean.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
Right now, we're having a lot of problem in that area, correct? Around Dairy Queen area, right there where the Lucasa Village, or the nursing home area, all that area, we're having big trouble with the sewer lines, correct?
Some of the connections, but that's on actually Highway 181.
Yes, well, this is right across the street. We're all going to the same place.
To the main that this is tying to 181, it goes down to J Street, and then runs down J Street, crosses Hospital Boulevard, and then comes down behind the old hospital and runs into the system there by the Highway 97 bus station. I'm not aware of any problems in that area.
There was connection with the hotel. There's an issue with the hotel, but it's on the other side of the street, so it's not in the same lane.
Yeah, that's probably a specific service issue. Probably. I haven't heard about that problem, but we're on the other side of the road in a different surname.
It all leads to the same spot, so.
Yes, sir. I don't anticipate it.
No, I'm just asking the question. That's it. I don't know if you have looked into it or not.
And well, I'll certainly get with the Director of Public Works and City Manager to talk about that problem we're talking about across the street, across the main line.
Now, this is the plans to put in some pressure tanks or sewer pump sections?
Yeah, there is because the first half, the front part of the project closer to 181 does gravity flow into that sewer main, but the back portion, because of the elevation of the site, it can't gravity flow. So there is a requirement for the developer to install a privately maintained lift station. And that's, we identified that on the plat so that there is a, before they issue any building permits, they will need to provide the city documentation that they have a system, a maintenance agreement in place that addresses the maintenance of that lift station.
So at some time or another, the city of Florida is going to have to acquire that system, correct?
No. They would never be able to do it. It's not a public lift station. It's not being designed to meet TCQ requirements.
So the citizens are going to have to do it themselves?
It'll be the system maintained by those two lot owners who own that subdivision. We own those two lots in that proposed subdivision.
Yeah. Well, the reason I see where that area is, and it's a low-lying area.
Right.
You would have to have some type of lift station, I guess.
Right. They weren't able to cross the. There's a natural low between that runs behind the lots on J Street, between this site and the J Street lots. And because of that low elevation, they can't cross with a gravity main connect over to the main of J Street. And so that's why the back half of that last lot, the second lot, has to pump over the hill to their service line.
Are you going to have to go through other property owners' property?
That's all contained within proposed easements that are going to be created by this plat.
How many families will be able to live there?
How many duplexes are there? Okay. Eight duplexes, so there'll be eight units, eight residences only, right? 16 residences, okay. So 16 residences.
16 families. And how wide is the lot? How big is the lot?
The lot itself?
No, we have a plat in front of me.
Well, some of them vary.
We have the engineer that prepared the plat.
Same size?
According to this area.
Yes.
Okay.
Any more comments? Questions?
And this went through the planning and zoning?
Yes, it did.
Yes, sir. And it was, they were given approval. There's no more comments or questions, I'll entertain a motion.
And the city's going to pay for the 6-inch water line?
No, ma'am, that's the developer.
Part of this, commercial, somewhere else then.
If I'm not mistaken, you have to rezone the front half to business, because right now it's all resident.
So resident or commercial?
Resident. Lot one, which is 0.7 acres, would have to rezone as commercial.
That's the part right up to 181, that would be rezoned commercial.
Yeah.
So y'all start the pipes until y'all get rezoning, right?
But you have to rezone before they can get a permit.
It has to be approved by us and the citizens that live around in the area.
We need permits forward to do construction, so right now we're just rezoning a plat at this point.
So I entertain a motion for this item.
I'd make motion to approve the final plat for 6.